This Wednesday morning, we want to talk about leadership and integrity. And these are the faces that will be taking us through this conversation. As on my closer end, on my left, I have David Osiani, who is a governance and public expert, not a stranger to this show. It's great to see you, David.
Thank you.
I believe it's the first time for this year.
Happy New Year.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Also, not a stranger to this show, we have Harriet Shigai, who is the LSK Vice President. It's great to see you again.
Thank you.
And sitting next to her, we have Caroline Gaita, who is the Executive Director at Mzalendo Trust. It's great to have you again.
Thank you.
And of course, with us, KMPDU Secretary General, one and only Dr. Ouma Oluga. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for your time this morning. Leadership and integrity is our discussion for today. And I think the perfect place perhaps to begin is what's even on the daily papers, with Uhuru's sort of reshuffling his cabinet. And David, I'll perhaps begin with you on this side. The reshuffle that we sort of saw from President Uhuru Kenyatta yesterday, with about give or take 2 years to his end of legacy. Do you think that this is the sort of action you'd have wanted to see from the president?
Well, Zinzi, we have to appreciate that foremost, a lot of cabinet slots have been remaining vacant for a bit too long. Mm-hmm. Some all too sensitive, like Treasury, that right. had a cabinet secretary doubling up since the firing of the former CS. Mm. But also the cabinet, as has been a bit divided, you know, politically.
Right.
And so the president had to address that bit. You know, when you talk about governance, you must always understand that the three pillars of political governance are power, politics, and policy. Mm-hmm. And the three of them must marry in order for even the policies that we want to work. Mm-hmm. And so I saw the CS, former CS for Agriculture, becoming a casualty, Mwangi Kiunjuri. That was long coming.
Right.
Because obviously he had undermined the president a bit too frontally, mm-hmm. which was not well advised. So it had to come. Uhuru had to reassert his authority. But in terms of, you know, making appointments to fill vacant positions to ensure, which is very impressive for me, mm-hmm. that the cabinet, mm-hmm. at the cabinet level, meets the gender rule threshold, that was excellent and stellar, mm-hmm. which then saw the very brilliant Betty Maina taking a slot in the cabinet when many people thought that because of the balancing of the politics of the region in Rift Valley, Dr. Chris Kipto would have been the obvious fit in because he comes from Elgeyo Marakwet, like the former CS for mm-hmm. Treasury.
Right.
And so that for me is quite something. It is good for the country to sort that out so that then we have a clear stairway forward for policy.
All right, let me get the thoughts of the rest. Harriet, what do you make of this new reshuffle move that we saw yesterday?
Thank you very much. Let's just start by saying that it is important that within any governance structure, mm-hmm. you fill each and every gap. We cannot look the other way and say there were no gaps. There were gaps to be filled, and one of them is Treasury, you know, which is a very, very, very important docket. And you can imagine if you have someone acting in such a crucial position for a very long time, then what kind of authority do they have? What kind of guidance do they give within that sphere? Mm-hmm. Now we are yet to see the real attorney, because now he has the authority.
Right.
Now he has been given the authority. So we are yet to see now the real CS of Treasury. And I think we are all looking forward to see what changes can be made within that ministry. Mm-hmm. In terms of politics and general governance, you'll agree with me that whenever you're a leader and you're holding certain key positions at stake, it's important you have a cabinet that speaks to the mandate, that speaks to your vision, that speaks to your passion, that is ready to deliver that which you have set to deliver. And by virtue of that, then it's not a surprise that Kiunjuri had to go.
Yes.
He actually dared the president in camera. And already, that is something that it's long overdue.
But how many other people, you know? How many other politicians have done the same thing?
There's difference between being a politician out there and being within the cabinet that is supposed to help deliver, let's say, the agenda for. Appointed by the president. So the presidency as an office, no matter what, you must respect it.
Right.
You know? And that boils down to any other leadership portfolio. Mm. If you're not ready, then step out. If you're not in agreement, then step out. If you're not able to deliver, step out and allow others to take those positions, because We have many, 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 many Kenyans, including the person seated here, who can sit in any cabinet position and deliver, you know, ably. So you find that when it comes to leadership and governance, it's very, very important that when you're on that seat, you drive the passion, you drive the vision, you drive the mandate of government. And at times it's good to exercise these duties in a manner to suggest that we are very, very, very professional, because only then, and when you look at the kind of ministries that all the CSAs hold, they have so many other dockets under them, including the international space.
Right.
You'll realize that ambassadors actually report to the CSAs. So you find that their responsibility goes beyond just them being in that particular seat.
Right.
For us women, I think it's a plus. And with that, I want to thank the president because he gave us one more slot. We celebrate each. We need more, but we celebrate each and every slot that we added as women.
Caroline,
just,
are you?
Just before Caroline, you know, Mwangi Kiunjuri in his rejoinder stated that he had seen this and it was long coming.
Yep.
Now, I have respect for a man who has the sense and in the sense of decency to quit before he is asked. If he had seen it long coming, it only means that he either knew his vision had departed from the president's vision, who appointed him, or that they had now become diametrically opposed, either politically or in terms of policy or way forward. And so for him to wait to be asked and try to play the, you know, the sympathy card, victimhood, that is not right. That is not right even politically, especially when he did not deliver in his mandate as the CS1.
You're reading my mind, David, and we're going to come to that specific point that you brought up as well. Caroline, for you, are you confident with this new fresh moves that we're seeing, just as David and Harriet are this morning?
I am. I think it was just slight movements here and there, but I think the starting point for me is if you want to deliver, you need a team that is delivering with you. And I think by having this cabinet reshuffle, that's what the president tried to do.
Yes.
I was especially interested in the ministries of agriculture because especially in his backyard, there really has been complaints about agriculture. And so it was no surprise that he took the move that he did. And I think that Munya is well appraised of the challenges that are facing that region that has raised a lot of issues. Of course, it was interesting to see that he also made changes in the water ministry, which if you go back to the issues of the dams, that could be interesting. So for me, I think it's whether the president's team is now aligned to his Big Four agenda vision is a question that we should be discussing. And obviously with Yatani now being a substantive CS in Treasury, hopefully that will give us a direction on the way forward.
Yes.
We've already seen some slight movements in the recent months. We've seen a bit of payments for outstanding debts and hopefully that's a good move. So I want to believe that he has chosen the team that he believes is going to take him forward in where he, the vision that he outlined in his speech.
Right, right. All right, Dr. Ouma, let me come to you now. Yours is very specific. As a health doctor, you have a new CS. Are you confident also in the new CS? Are you confident with the changes? Mutahi Kagwe is now the new CS of health. I've seen a few doctors giving one or two confidence in him.
We as the health fraternity, we will welcome him very much, and we look very much forward to working closely with him.
But coming.
We believe, given his track record, that he's very sober. And when you're sober, we also believe that he will be very professional. There is quite a lot on his plate as he comes. There are many healthcare institutions that are not firmly established. The Health Act has never been implemented. And I know he is a man that has the ear of the president. So healthcare workers are also hoping that he will deliver the Health Service Commission, which was also part of the BBI recommendations, to solve the chaos that has been in the sector for quite some time in terms of management of health workers, in terms of addressing public complaints. We have regulatory bodies and authorities that are not constituted, including the medical council. So even today, if you went to hospital and something happened to you, you're mistreated, or there is a malpractice, or there's a misdiagnosis, there's actually nowhere to complain to because the medical council is not constituted. So we hope that those are the things that will be done in his first week of office. Mm-hmm. So there is quite a lot on his plate. And then there's still the UHC agenda.
Yes, one of the big four.
Which
agendas,
is one of the big four agenda. So I think the president has given him quite a task. You know, they say that if you are to whom much is...
given much is required.
Much is required. Mm-hmm. So I think that is why I believe the president perhaps was giving such a hand. We also think that given his political background, health is quite political in a way. Yes, it's very professional, and it's also quite political in terms of the decision making, that he will be very human in terms of delivering a system of care that speaks to the needs of every Kenyan, because health has been second only to politics in terms of the discussions of Kenyans in the last 2 or 3 years. So, if you remove politics from the everyday discussions, I think healthcare comes very close, whatever you're talking about, whether it's about road safety, whether it's about locusts, whether it's about food security.
Health is
everything is health.
Right.
Yeah. In fact, health comes very close to everything. So, in fact, looking at the cabinet reshuffle, for me, I was interpreting that mm-hmm. the president is trying to firmly have a grip mm-hmm. on the big four agenda. Mm-hmm. So, you're looking at food security,
manufacturing
with Betty Maina,
yes.
Health with Mutahi Kagwe, and then now the housing, which is still under the transport and mm-hmm. Housing mm-hmm. department with Masharia. So politically speaking, for us we're very neutral usually, and we just want to look forward to achieving the things that are important mm-hmm. for the country. But
right.
But as we've said, I think Mutahi Kagwe is a bit political, so we hope that he will deliver the Health Service Commission better, because that's a political delivery,
mm-hmm.
and that's exactly what we expect,
okay.
and no less,
definitely. Harriet, 2 years to go. This reshuffle has just come yesterday. Is time on their side?
Well, one, I believe that the institutions are there. If it's blueprints, they are there. What we need is delivery. These institutions have been there for some time, and I can tell you for sure, even when we talk about health, I'm sure there are proposals already sitting somewhere on how we can improve health in this country. When you look where we are in terms of management, especially on current diseases that are really and literally killing Kenyans, like cancer, what is the rocket science around that? Issues to do with our health goes way beyond just the actual treatment. Medical equipment, but also the kind of food that we are eating.
Yes.
So we want to see measures put in place to ensure that now any food that is out there in the market is actually good food for Kenyans. Now marry that, because on matters health, we need to start having preventive measures vis-a-vis corrective measures.
Mm-hmm.
Corrective measures become very expensive. Now, when we look at the amounts of money that we lose in this country, I can assure you we can equip all referral hospitals in this country and even come up with better facilities to ensure that Kenyans get the best medical care. And I'll tell you one thing for a fact. Insurance companies right now are the ones who are making millions out of this. Whether they're making profits or not, I think you can see every other day there's a new product to service a particular health issue. So you can imagine what we are dealing with right now.
Dr. Ouma, are we using social issues? Are we using political answers to address social issues? You said right now that as much as health is there, it's also very political.
Yeah, but the system that we have to make decisions all over the world is politics. So whether you are a professor, whether you're a doctor, whether you're a poor man in the village, whether you're a teacher, the way to make policies, the way to distribute resources, the way to have your voice is politics.
All right, let me read for you what Kiunjuri said yesterday, ladies and gentlemen. He says, and I quote, "The president's decision has taken me by no surprise.
Mm.
I thank God I feel relieved. I have endured lots of humiliation. Only God and my family knows this. I have given my best in my assignment. I live with my head high. David talked about how if he saw that coming, it was no surprise for him. It would have been the honorable thing to retire or quit. We've seen this happening in other communities, in other countries. I mean, Caroline, when will we get a time, when will we see a time like that happening in Kenya? Oh, Dr. Ouma is about to jump in, but let me get here for Caroline.
I think that we were expecting him to resign before he was fired. It would have been a surprise itself, because in Kenya's history, we haven't, only in very few cases have you seen people resigning on the basis of principle.
If he did that, do you think he would have still secured his career?
I'm not so sure, because we must start from the issues that he's facing. Agriculture, especially from the, if I speak from where I come from, which is central, there are a lot of issues with farmers that are not being addressed. And for me, the fact that he was not addressing those issues is the bigger problem and challenge, other than he's being fired. Mm-hmm. So if he was addressing the issues and then he was having a political problem, we'd be having a different conversation. But he wasn't delivering, and he wasn't aligned to his boss's vision. Right. Those are two big problems that needed to be dealt with.
Right. And we've seen in other communities, we've seen people, political leaders, resign because they came late for a meeting, 5 minutes late for a meeting. When do we see that sort of integrity and leadership here in Kenya?
Let me first deal with the very former CS for agriculture. I sit on the board of Chemelil Sugar Company. Mm-hmm. We have tried to engage with the CS to find solution for the sugar sector. And it may be right that solutions for that sector may well ascend to the highest seat of this country, which is the presidency. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But there didn't seem to me as though there was any desire
or interest
mm-hmm. to fix that sector. Mm-hmm. The Sugar Task Force report was done and completed almost a year ago. No word on it, it's gathering dust. In fact, I expected the president to address himself as comprehensively as he did on tea about sugar.
Yeah.
Because that is the mainstay of the people of the Western region in this country. Mm-hmm. Kids are not going to school. I was raised by sugar money. My father has just retired from Sony Sugar Company. Mm. That's how I was raised. Now, a lot of kids who would have afforded to go to school, as I speak to you now, who scored very highly, who were guaranteed of opportunities in schools because their parents had salaries or had wages from the sugar cane itself, or that the farmers had money in their pockets, are unable to go to school, as I speak to you. Mm-hmm. Now, Mwangi Kiunjuri did not deliver on that mandate. Did it have to take the president to come and deal with Sokohuru in the tea sector, bedeviling Central Province? Mwangi, who comes from Laikipia, who knows only too well that, for example, Laikipia, every year there are perishable things like tomatoes that go to waste, mm-hmm. has not in his head thought
right.
that why don't we build coolers until the president says, now we are going to build one in Nyahururu, mm-hmm. in Kisii, and Nyeri. Mm-hmm. Did it have to take the president to do the job of the man he has assigned? The job. Mm-hmm. And that's why I say, if Mwangi Kiunjuri had understood, you know, that unless there is something we don't know, unless he attempted and he was frustrated, mm-hmm. and I wouldn't know by who, but because politics is the way it is, if he knew that either he was incapable or that he wasn't willing to pursue and accomplish some of these things that were requisite of his role as the cabinet secretary for agriculture, livestock and irrigation, fisheries and irrigation, then Mwangi would have done the country the honors to quit in time. Now, secondly, politically, you don't go threatening an African president. Because African presidents have, we have a constitution which we hope they abide by,
yes.
but they have a tendency
yes.
to step outside that constitution sometimes and deal with you ruthlessly.
So what is democracy then?
Democracy is a wonderful thing generated in the West. Doesn't work well for African context, but I am a proponent for democracy.
Yes.
But it doesn't help for Mwangi Kiunjuri to tell the president, for every action there will be a reaction. Because you don't, some of these people can pursue, I'm talking politics, leave the books, as Chegai will tell us, mm-hmm. how it should be by the book. Mm-hmm. We know that it steps out of the book. Tomorrow he will be hounded. The only politician I know who has survived in the cold for so long and still wields influence is Raila Odinga. All these other political leaders lose their influence, especially if they are going to be pursued for issues of governance that were in their dockets at the time they were leaders there.
Dr. Ouma, you also had something to bring in. And even as you give your comment on that, could we as a reflect as a nation, as ourselves? Because the same CSAs tomorrow will be chosen as governors, as senators, ETC. Yeah. So really, who are we feeling? Who are we fooling,
so,
rather?
So that is exactly what I wanted to talk about. So I know this has been a big discussion. So mm-hmm. we have to go back to the whole value system in the society.
Yes.
And the reason why people hold positions. Many people want positions. Many of us would want to be appointed cabinet secretaries, mm-hmm. to be governors, to be MPs. But very few of us want the responsibility that comes with those positions.
Sure.
And this is the underlying cancer in this country. And this is even related to what we want to discuss about the issues of integrity. Because I want to be Secretary General of the doctors, but I don't want to be there to have the responsibility that comes with that position,
mm-hmm.
of sometimes making the hard decisions,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes being in an uncomfortable position,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes, you know, being put in a position where even you have to forgo some of the personal things,
right.
to achieve things. And I think if there's advice that I would like to give to mm-hmm. Kenyans, and if there is a persuasion that I would like to have for leaders, is just work
mm-hmm.
for the people. And you've said that it is Raila who has survived and a few other people. I think it's because of the trust that a section of people, or a large majority of people, have on this. If you want to survive, it is the people that must give you that mandate.
So we're the ones who put them there. So can we confidently say that we are also to blame as the citizens?
Exactly, and I was coming to that, mm-hmm. because, so if we have this value system, that if I am a cabinet secretary, my first and foremost responsibility, yes, I have been appointed by the president. Yes, the president is the authority through which Kenyans gave mandate to appoint me. But I have to work for the people.
Right, right.
I have to work for my country. I just have to do the right thing. I have to do the right thing for agriculture. I have to do the right thing for health. I have to do the right thing for education. For that child who cannot afford, for that farmer whose milk is going bad, who is being conned, for the patient, you know?
Yeah.
Somewhere deep down in Kibera or somewhere in Laikipia,
mm-hmm.
you know, who
mm-hmm.
cannot, who does not even know the MCA, who does not know what to do. They just know I am in pain. They don't know what they are suffering from.
Right.
This is the person that we have to work for. But this is the person that we, as leaders in this country, really work for. And this is where the issue about Kiunjuri saying that I saw it long coming. Well, unlike my colleagues, perhaps, I don't comment so much on politics. So I didn't see it all coming. But if he saw it all coming, I disrespect the position that he saw it all coming, and he never took
action about it.
Action about it.
Right.
And that's the thing. So we have this political patronage in this country,
mm-hmm.
where we hold positions for the purposes of other things other than the people. So you cannot speak, you cannot quit, you cannot act. But then why are you holding this position? And this goes all the way to many dockets, and I have mentioned to you in the health sector, many positions, for example, are in acting, you know, acting CEOs, the council is not there. But what happens to that woman who will go to the hospital today and wants to have a complaint?
Mm.
Who is going to address their issue?
All right, we need to take a quick commercial break. I'll come back with Harriet, even on matters, what Uhuru said, President Uhuru Kenyatta said yesterday on matters judiciary and graft. I'd love to hear from Caroline on how we as Kenyans ourselves have glossified political position. Dr. Ouma has said how certain people go for them, neglecting the current responsibilities that come with that docket. Right now, this is our question that we're asking you, our viewers at home, so you can be part of this conversation. Let it come up on your screens right now. We're asking you, are you confident in President Uhuru Kenyatta's recent cabinet reshuffle? Are you confident in President Uhuru Kenyatta's recent cabinet reshuffle? Talk to us at Zinzi underscore K, at Trevor on BG, at Citizen TV is also officially on Twitter. Also, you can text us on 22422. Let's take that breather. We'll be right back.